Hi everyone and welcome here again. For this video, I have an Intel NUC 12 Pro in front of me and during the video, I will completely disassemble this small machine, then reassemble it and perform some upgrades while doing so. I will upgrade the memory to 32GB and also install a faster 1TB NVMe SSD. Finally, we will take a look at how this small, but not to be underestimated device, is actually performing by doing some benchmarks. So here we have it, an Intel NUC 12 Pro. As you can see, this model is a bit taller and it's called the WSH variant of the NUC. But even being called tall, it's still not that big. The only difference with the Slim or WSK version is that this one has an additional space for a 2.5-inch drive at the bottom. You might have noticed already online that Asus gets mentioned a lot in relationship to the NUC. And that is because Intel announced in July 2023 that it would no longer develop and manufacture these small form factor NUC devices. Instead, Asus will be the one responsible for releasing new versions and they also took over the support of the older models. This specific model was released back in the end of 2022, still by Intel. As you can guess by the naming, it is equipped with a 12th generation Intel Core CPU, part of the Alder Lake family. I did mention already that this is a small device, also called a mini PC, but to put things in perspective, it's even smaller than the recent Apple Mac Mini, which in a lot of cases would be the direct competitor for it. When looking at the exact size, we're talking about 11.7 by 11.2 centimeters. So it's almost square, and the tall variant, which this is 5.4 centimeter in height. This makes it very easy to put it somewhere on your desk, mount it behind your monitor, or just hide it somewhere else and opens a lot of possibilities for various applications. Let's take a better look at our NUC. On the front of the machine, we can find a power button, headphones jack, USB 3.2 Gen 2 with power delivery and another regular USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type A port. On the back, we can find the power input, 1, 2 HDMI ports, the same amount of USB Type-C Thunderbolt 4 ports, a 2.5 gigabit Ethernet port, another USB 3.2 Gen 2 port, and the legacy USB 2.0 port. On the bottom here, you can see that there is also room for further expansion, which could provide room for something like a serial port, for example. The power for this machine is provided by a 20-volt 120-watt power adapter, at least for the i5 and i7 variant, which, to my personal opinion, might be a bit of a disadvantage over something like a Mac Mini, which has an integrated power supply instead. On the other hand, having the power supply external and the ability to provide DC power directly to the NUC makes it easier to integrate in embedded applications. Now that we know the outside, let's have a look inside. This begins by loosening the four screws at the bottom. After untightening these, you can easily loosen them completely by hand. And once all four are done, you can pull out the bottom of the case. Be careful here, especially when you have this WSH variant as I do, as there is a flat cable that provides a SATA connection between the two parts. By lifting this white clip first, you can then disconnect that cable and separate these two parts. The bottom part has thermal pads to conduct the heat away from the M.2 drives, and under there we can see the connector and space for a 2.5-inch drive, which then can be fixed by replacing these rubber inserts with screws. In the top part we can find space for an M.2 NVMe SSD, a B-key SATA SSD, that SATA connector to the bottom drive, and the memory. In these two slots, we currently have two DDR4 SODIMMs of 8GB installed, which we will remove. Then, we can get the NVMe SSD out. This is currently a Samsung 970 EVO Plus of 500GB, but as I told already, I'll replace it with something better later. Under the NVMe drive, we can see another M.2 slot, which has the Wi-Fi adapter installed. To get it out, we first need to remove those tiny antenna connectors. Then remove the screw that holds it in place. So, here would be more or less where it stops for regular serviceable parts of the NUC. But let us go a few steps further. After turning over the device, it's possible to carefully remove the top cover, which is just held in place with a few plastic clips. Under that cover, we can find the Wi-Fi antennas, but also four more screws that hold the rest of the assembly fixed to the case. From the bottom side, we need to remove two more screws then. And the expansion cover will need to be taken out as well. Which means that now we should be able to get the motherboard out of the case. Everything fits tightly together, so it can take a bit of wiggling and pulling here and there, but eventually, with a healthy dose of force and patience, you should be able to get the board out. On the top side of the board, we can see the CPU fan with the CPU underneath. On the other side, we went over most of the components already. We have the M.2 slot for Wi-Fi, M.2 for the NVMe SSD, another one for a SATA SSD, and a SATA connector to the bottom. Here we also have a BIOS security jumper, a front panel header, additional USB headers, and eventually those two memory slots. Let's put everything back together now, starting by putting back the motherboard in the case. Then we can fix it back from this side. And before we can reinstall the Wi-Fi adapter, let's make sure that the antenna cables are guided properly first. Now let's put the card back in the M.2 slot and fix it. And then comes the fun part, to fix these tiny MHF connectors back to the card. Okay, there we go. Glad we got that out of the way. And let's put in our first upgrade now. This Western Digital Black NVMe SSD of 1 TB. Curious to see how this will perform in the benchmarks. Now comes our second upgrade. These two 16 GB memory DIMMs will replace the originally installed 8 GB modules. There we go. All components are installed now, and all we need to do is to complete the assembly. Let's put back that expansion cover. The four screws on top. And eventually the top cover as well. On the bottom, we still need to put back that SATA flat cable by first lifting the white clip and pushing it down after inserting the cable. All that's left now is to put back the bottom part and fix it back with the four screws in each corner. There we go. Alright, I got the NUC connected to a monitor, keyboard and mouse, and let's see if it still works. By pressing F2, we should enter the BIOS, so let's take a look here first. At the main screen, we can see our specifications. As CPU, we indeed see a 12th generation Intel Core CPU. Specifically, our device is equipped with an i7-1260P. As you can see, this is actually a mobile CPU, primarily designed for laptops, which does make sense in this small enclosure with limited space for cooling, of course. We can also see that this CPU has 4 performance cores, which can run up to a crazy 4.7 GHz, and 8 efficiency cores, which go up to 3.4 GHz. This combination should perform pretty well, but let's see about that in the benchmarks later. Further in the BIOS, we can see the upgraded memory for a total of 32 GB now, running at 3200 MHz. And in the advanced tab, we can also navigate to storage and see the SSD which we installed, so it looks like everything is detected as desired. Other than this, the options in the BIOS are not too limited, so that's always good news. Let's exit now from here and boot into Windows 11. Bit strange to see the F key boot options displayed on the boot screen while Windows is already busy starting up, and that looks like a pretty ugly bug to my idea. But okay, we managed to get into Windows 11, and of course we need to start by having a look at About this PC, where we can see the exact same information as we got in the BIOS setup. One thing worth mentioning about Windows 11 here, in case you would doubt between 11 and 10, is that this CPU is equipped with performance and efficiency cores. This means that the scheduler in Windows 11 handles these more efficiently, at least in theory. If you would still really want only Windows 10, then you need to make sure to go with version 21H2 or higher. Okay, let's open Task Manager now to get a bit more detail. Here we have the CPU, where we see all cores and threads, the memory, which displays as the speed as we could see in the BIOS as well, and our NVMe drive. Time for some benchmarks now, and as I always do, I will start with a CPU benchmark in Geekbench 5. 1686 single core and 9447 multi-core. That's pretty impressive for the small box we have here. Comparing this with the results from my M1-based MacBook Air, for example, which should perform similar to an M1 Mac Mini, we see quite a bit better performance. Even if we compare it with a regular M2, this system gives us a better result, but an M2 Pro is definitely faster. Let's do the same now with Geekbench 6. Again, we're getting a very respectable score with 2335 for single core and 9915 for multi-core. As with the previous test, we can see comparable results for the competing Mac Mini hardware, largely faster than the M1 generation and similar in performance to a regular M2-based system. So far, with CPU performance, there is nothing to complain about, I would say. Let's see if that's also the case for our Western Digital NVMe drive, which we upgraded. Well, yeah, I think that's pretty good too. We can see 5 GB per second sequential read performance with a large block size and slightly less with smaller blocks. Random read is good as well, but I think something went wrong with that last test, which seems a bit off. And write performance shows even better numbers. All of these are close to the limits of the PCIe slot and the SSD itself, so this drive will definitely not be the bottleneck here. Let's also see how the integrated graphics of the CPU perform. With these newer CPUs, these start to be a bit relevant. Not like a dedicated GPU, unfortunately, but also not completely worthless. In Geekbench 5, we're getting 17,390. Again, better than what an M1 can deliver, but not in line with a dedicated GPU at all, as even a GTX 960, which is from 2015 already, outperforms this by a lot. With Geekbench 6, we're getting only 15,239, and strange enough, this results in no lower than what an M1 can do. Still, similar as with the previous test, we can see that both of these aren't anywhere close to an old dedicated GPU, let alone something more recent. Let's also test Wi-Fi performance. I'm doing this by copying over a large file from a network share over the wireless network. We're connected to an 802.11ax access point, which means Wi-Fi 6, and the AP is also in good range. The server from which we are copying is connected with a cable and can easily fill up its gigabit connection, so the limitation is really this machine, perfect to test. As you can see, we're getting around 350 to 400 megabit per second, or 45 to 50 megabyte per second here. I think that's a proper and realistic number on what to expect of the Wi-Fi 6 adapter which we have. I also tried to run 3DMark on this machine, but as we could already expect from the Geekbench GPU or compute test, this was not a great success. During the test, I didn't manage to get the fluent experience at all, and overall the frame rate is really too low to consider this machine seriously for gaming. The resulting score reflects this experience, but what is good news is that during this extensive test, which takes a while, the temperature in the chassis stayed very reasonable and stable, and even more important, I don't see any signs of the CPU throttling back at all. This means that although this is not the best device for gaming, it does manage to perform well over a long time and under heavy load. The only disadvantage is that the fan can get quite loud while doing so. And that concludes this video. All in all, I'm pretty impressed with this tiny computer. The performance results are above my expectations for both CPU, memory, and disk. The lack of GPU power does make this device unsuitable for gaming, but performance for other tasks like video or photo editing or other more serious work will not disappoint you. As mentioned a few times, the performance here is in line with an M2-based Mac Mini, although that one will be more quiet and use less energy. So it depends a bit on your personal preference, budget, and choice of operating system, of course. Thank you for watching. I hope you have enjoyed this video, and if that's the case, I'd appreciate a thumbs up. Let me know if you have this device or any questions in the comments, and if you like these kind of videos, make sure to subscribe to my channel and enable notifications. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.